Yep. I might get more views if I have a dog in the frame. How do you feel about this? Are you into it? Are you not into it? What's the vibe? This could not have worked out any better. Today I'm filming random things that I found out about film scores that I thought were fun and funky and just cool fun facts. I don't know. I don't know what you want from me. Okay, I'm very clearly unprepared for this video. Do you see my background? Do you see my not well shaded background that I made with fabric that I bought for $6 each from the fabric shop? Do you think I'm prepared for this? No. The Oppenheimer score was written by Ludwig Göransson. I don't know if that's how you say his name. I don't know what the two little dots above the O mean. I have never heard a more just unique and well written thing in my life. I went there with my friend. I dragged him along to come see it with me. He'd already seen it. I was like, no, you need to come see it with me again. But he's created like these wailing sounds in the background, like it literally sounds like a bomb. It sounds like a bomb dropping in the background, in the score. You can hear it. In Netflix's Nimona, also spoilers for Nimona, if you haven't seen Nimona, go watch Nimona. You have Netflix, I know you have Netflix, fucking everyone has Netflix. If you don't have Netflix, I know that you definitely have someone else's login. Steal their login, go in, log in, and then watch Nimona. Spoilers for Nimona. There's a character named Ballister, and basically he's been framed for killing the queen.
The queen's dead! The queen!
So he's like, shit, everyone is out to get me right now. So he hides, and then Nimona finds him and is like, yo, let's go fucking fuck some bitches up. She basically wants to help him be a villain. She thinks he's a villain, but he's not a villain, and he's trying to find out who is the villain so that he can go back to his life being a god, I guess. But they have to basically go in and get evidence that the magistrate did it.
Hello, editing Brooke here. I kept fucking calling the director the magistrate, and I don't know why, but her name is the director. I just fucked up. So every time I say the magistrate, just input, like, just pretend that I'm saying the director, because her name is the director.
So she shifts as Ballister's boyfriend and then fakes her death, but not really fakes her death because the magistrate kills her as him. Makes sense? You're following? And they recorded it, and then they're like, woohoo! Then we have the evidence we need to basically show that the magistrate is a bitch. And they upload the YouTube video, and while this is all happening, there is a very lovely montage of just them celebrating. The song that plays in the background, Gold Guns Girls by Metric, that's the song that plays in the background during this little fun little montage. One of the lyrics in this song is it ever gonna be enough? To which the regular person probably wouldn't even think about that too much. Like, it's a very girl bossy song, you get into it, you know? The whole point of this film is that, like, you shouldn't judge people that are different to you. Like, people are gonna be different to you, don't judge them, be understanding, be empathetic, whatever. But everyone is against Nimona and Ballister, and everyone's basically with the magistrate. So even when they upload this, they have the evidence. There's no way it can go wrong because they have everything they need to basically prove the magistrate killed the queen. It literally asks, is it ever gonna be enough? Which it's not, because 10 minutes later in the film, the magistrate just gets up on stage and is like, yo guys, wasn't me. Next thing on my list is Interstellar. Now, Interstellar has been very well known to just have an amazing score. Like, that's just something that people know about Interstellar. Like, it's fucking good. But the thing I picked up about it is that the moment, because Cooper, he's the main guy, right? There's like a, I'm not gonna give you context for the film every time. I'm just gonna assume that people have watched the film. Watch Interstellar. If you haven't watched Interstellar, I don't know what you're doing. Like, it's a well-known film. People know this film. Go watch Interstellar. But score is written by Hans Zimmer, and the plotline of the story is like basically there's, you know, Cooper, he's out in space, needs to get back from space because every minute he's gone is like a year back on Earth and he has kids and shit. But the moment he leaves the house and goes, there's like a ticking that starts in the film, and it only starts after he leaves the house. Like, before, all the music before he leaves is all fine, like there's no ticking in that, and then it starts once he leaves. Just in the background, subtly. Which is just, it's such a simple thing. And it's just there, and it's like, you didn't put that you didn't have to put that there. The score would have been amazing if you didn't put that there, but you did. Hans Zimmer is very good. Hans Zimmer is a very good composer. I will give him a high five. He's chill as fuck. He's really good. This isn't, I need everyone to know. I don't know if this is true. I don't know if this is a thing. This is just something that me and my friend picked up once and we thought it was really cool. I have this friend that I met at Film School and he's like, we'll call him Marlon because his name is Marlon. But he wants to be a film director. Like, he's really good. Like, he knows all the really niche, like, old films, Golden Day films. Like, he's just, like, has infinite knowledge in film. And I'll be so real, it's really hard for me to, like, it's really hard to convince me to watch anything that isn't animated because I'm a fucking child. So I asked him one day, I was like, hey, what's your go-to must-watch film fanatic, like, movie that everyone should see at least once in their life? And the film he gave me was Once Upon a Time in the Old West. But the composer for that film, his name is, oh my god, I don't know how to say his name, Ennio Morricone. He composed the score for that film. And I had never heard him before because I had never watched any old Western films. So it was my first time hearing him. And I was like, wow, this guy's really cool. Like, and this is, like, he's a talented composer. Like, you know the wah, 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 in all the old films? He did that. He wrote that. That was him. That was this guy. That was him. He's big. He's a good composer. There's a point where the specific track plays called Once Upon a Time in the Old West theme at 1 minute 31 seconds. There's like a build up in the song. And I was listening to it and I was like, oh my fucking god. It sounds exactly like the same buildup that is in E.T. when he's getting ready to go on the ship to like go home. It sounds so similar. I called Marlon, I was like, yo, dude, have you fucking heard this shit? And he was like, what? And I told him, and then he was like, oh my god! Morricone started composing in like the 40s, like early 40s, and then John Williams, who did the E.T. score for anyone who doesn't know, and he started in the late 50s. So we've got a little idea going on there that maybe Mr. John Williams watched a couple films from Morricone that he liked and he got a little bit of inspiration, which is very cool. Don't know if it's true, but if it was true, I'd be a little bit giddy about that fact. This would not be a video about film scores if I did not bring up the Into the Spider-Verse series at least once, okay? But Gwen Stacy's main theme, the those things, that keeps reappearing in her score, that's actually made up of the same notes that the original Spider-Man theme is made of. Which is really cool. So, Danny Pabottom, Danielle. Well done, Daniel. Well done, Daniel. Damn, Daniel! Like and subscribe if you want, but don't. You know, I can't really do anything if you don't, so. But I'll see you in the next video. Bye-bye! Bye-bye! I'm Markiplier now, guys.
Bye-bye! Yeah!